Hi, why does a golf ball have dimples? Why do they sometimes use tripwires or zigzag tape on model aircraft? If you stay tuned, you will know. In this video, we will treat the phenomenon of separation of the boundary layer from an object. Boundary layer separation has major consequences for the drag and lift of objects, and therefore it is, of course, worth studying. Let us take the flow over a circular cylinder as an example. Here's a picture of a calculation of the flow around a two-dimensional cylinder at a low Reynolds number of 20,000. Two-dimensional means infinitely long, right? As you can see, the flow forms vortices at both sides of the cylinder while separating. If we look at the upper surface in more detail, we see there are various vortices tumbling over each other and that there is also fluid flowing in the reverse direction. Now let us first look at the flow over the cylinder when there is no friction. The distance over the contour from the stagnation point is expressed as the angle theta. The graph gives the pressure coefficient with theta going from the stagnation point at theta is 0 to the back of the cylinder at theta is 180 degrees. We now know that in the stagnation point we have the total pressure, so Cp is 1. As we go along the contour of the circle, the velocity goes up and the Cp goes down. Passing 90 degrees, the reverse happens, and at 180 degrees, the Cp is 1 again. There's no pressure difference between the front and the back of the cylinder. We also know that in reality there is friction, and that it has a significant effect on the flow around an object. Apart from friction along the surface of the cylinder, we also have a severe adverse pressure gradient at the back of the cylinder that will slow down the fluid. When the Reynolds number is low enough, in other words, if the effect of friction is high, the laminar boundary layer rapidly loses its energy, and before even transition can take place, it separates in an early stage from the surface, far before the thickest point of the cylinder, and makes a wide separated region at the back of the cylinder, which we call the wake, with a relatively low pressure. In the graph, this is shown with the red Cp line. The result is a significant pressure difference between the front and the back of the cylinder that wants to pull the cylinder back. The pressure drag of the cylinder is high. For bluff bodies like cylinders and spheres, due to separation, the contribution of the pressure drag to the total drag is many times more than the contribution of the friction drag. If we now increase the Reynolds number, for instance by increasing the velocity at constant cylinder diameter and flow conditions, then at a certain value, transition takes place at the cylinder and suddenly this turbulent boundary layer stays attached at the surface much longer. Now, why is that? Look at the boundary layer with the laminar and the turbulent profile. Due to the fact that the fluid particles in the turbulent boundary layer move chaotically, there is much more energy exchange between the outer part of the boundary layer, where there's much more kinetic energy, and the part of the boundary layer close to the wall. And you can see that there is more velocity near the wall, enough to endure more friction and to go against an adverse pressure gradient and to postpone separation. The result is shown in the Cp distribution. The pressure at the back of the cylinder has increased, the wake is smaller, and the pressure drag has decreased significantly. The Reynolds number at which this occurs is called the critical Reynolds number for a cylinder. Below this, we call the flow subcritical. You can see that the drag coefficient has gone down from 1.2 at the subcritical level to 25% of the initial value. If a turbulent boundary layer helps to reduce the pressure drag on the cylinder, then there are ways to lower the drag in the subcritical Reynolds number range by artificial transition. This can be done by putting roughness on the front of the cylinder, or by a wire on, or by grooves in the surface. Different kinds and sizes of roughness give different results, as can be seen here in this graph. This separation process is unsteady, especially for a cylinder at low Reynolds numbers. And this animation, although it's a bit psychedelic, it nicely shows what is going on. Forces excuse me, vortices alternately leave the surface from the top or the bottom, thus generating unsteady forces that will shake the cylinder up and down when it is not fixed. This phenomenon is called a Karman vortex street. You can experience it by yourself when you are in the bathtub. If there's a thin layer of foam on the water surface and you move your finger through the foam like this, you will see a Karman vortex street. And now this is on a small scale. But also on a larger scale, Karman vortex streets appear. For instance, behind a mountaintop that points into clouds, like you see on this satellite picture near the Juan Fernandez Islands close to the Chilean coast. What I've told you about cylinder is also true for a sphere. These phenomena have an application in sports as well. A golf ball has dimples so that it will have a higher speed. A tennis ball is hairy and has grooves, and a baseball has rough stitches, all for the same reason. Ever looked at the skin suits for speed skating or suits for bicycle time trials? They're not smooth on legs and arms. It's the same principle, applying roughness to avoid laminar separation, resulting in a lower drag. As you have noticed, a circle is a bad aerodynamic shape. And this picture speaks for itself, actually. The airfoil can be made 10 times thicker than the cylinder and still experiences the same drag force. This also shows the importance of streamlining. And talking about airfoils, the flow over airfoils shows the same behavior with increasing Reynolds number. At a very low Reynolds number, the flow shows laminar separation and transition takes place behind the airfoil in the wake. With increasing Reynolds number, transition moves forward in the direction of the leading edge, while the drag goes down, and when it has arrived at the leading edge, turbulent separation starts at the trailing edge, as we have seen in the pressure distributions of the DU airfoil in the previous video. This graph tells the story of the impact of the Reynolds number on the performance of a symmetrical airfoil. On the right-hand side, you see the lift coefficient versus the angle of attack, and on the left-hand side, you see the lift coefficient again, but now versus the associated drag coefficient. The flow at the low Reynolds number of 60,000 has laminar separation resulting in high drag and relatively low lift. Now, we will increase the Reynolds number twice with about a factor of 10. You can see that it has a favorable effect on lift and drag. At the highest Reynolds number, the maximum lift is more than twice the value at the lowest Reynolds number, and the drag coefficient has reduced with more than 50%. So, this concludes the story of separation. Next time more about airfoils.